Well, I'm Hal Swartz. I think most of you know me. I'm extremely honored and pleased to be chairing the inaugural presentation of what I think will be an extremely valuable series. As noted in the first slide, O2M Technologies is taking the time and effort to put together something that all of us can benefit from to give a snapshot of EPR oxygen imaging technology and related technologies and their applications. And they've already, as you'll see, have a very distinguished panel, with the exception of the person in April, who will be talking to you about various related subjects. My understanding is that if you miss these or if you want to review them, they're arranging for them to be online. So this is a quick overview of the talks coming up. This is the one today from Boris, which will be an overview of the concept of oxygen imaging principles and applications. The next one that's scheduled already is Howie Halperin, who will be talking about the quintessential application of EPR oxygen imaging and some really exciting things that they've already done on using the technology to potentially improve clinical outcomes. The next speakers, Greg Palmer from Duke, will be talking about 3D oxygen imaging, again, talking about radiation biology, because certainly oxygen and radiation biology and radiation therapy are just completely interdependent, and really you can't understand radiobiology, biological effects of radiation, without understanding oxygen. Then that will be followed in February. There'll be some intermediates from Carl Simon on the talk. The title's not there yet. Next one. We're going to take a step down here and have a discussion of EPR spectroscopy by some old fellow. And the next slide is coming backwards in time. Ariani is going to talk about oxygen imaging and biomaterials, which is a really exciting area. Biomaterials are a very important area, and how to understand their functioning in vivo really requires, among other things, really measuring the oxygen. So that's a really exciting application. And the next one is an encore in January for Boris, talking about their equipment. And then I think this now brings us to a quick introduction of Boris. So I think many of you know Boris. He started his education at the epicenter of EPR in Kazan, where EPR began, graduated in 1999, so he's no spring chicken anymore. That's 21 years ago. He's had a distinguished career working at several very important places, at Weizmann and Max Planck. In 2006, to the benefit of Boris and Howie and all of us, he went to the University of Chicago as part of that famous and still very effective center that's been set up there. Boris's role has been particularly in the development of the technology for advancing radiation treatments of cancer. He brings superb background in the understanding the physics and the spectroscopy and the software and in image processing. So I could go on and on, but I think what would be much more interesting than listening to me will be listening to Boris. So I will mute my phone, my microphone, and let Boris take over.
Thank you, Hal, for this nice introduction. And thank you, everybody, for joining our today's session. So let me start the presentation. Okay. So today, I will be introducing the field of electron paramagnetic oxygen imaging. And I will just talk about major items so we get a snapshot or understanding what's our target, what we're doing, and how we want to achieve our axiometric measurements. Okay, I will learn how to make slides. Okay, so after disclosures, I will move to my four major points of today. So these are low frequency PR instrumentation and methodology. And of course, important foundation pillar is spin probes, which can allow us to do oxygen imaging. I will move to the technology of pulse EPR oxygen imaging and very briefly name at least two applications, and more of that, of course, we will hear in the consequent lectures. Low frequency EPR. Electron paramagnetic resonance is based on the Zeeman effect. This effect is a splitting of the levels, energy levels in the constant magnetic field of magnetic particles. So if we have electron spin, its energy diagram will be looking like that. And what you can notice that with the increase of magnetic field, the splitting is increasing. And if you have particular excitation frequency, which is perfectly matching the magnetic field through the equation in the center, we will observe resonance absorption or emission of magnetic field. And this is the effect called magnetic resonance. So from this slide, you immediately can see what do we need to observe the resonance. First of all, we need a prominent magnet. We need a magnet which can create static magnetic field. The second thing we need is a source of the radio frequency radiation. And last but not least, of course, you need the object of study. In that case, in our case, this is electron spin. How our magnetic resonance, what we are doing on electrons, are related to magnetic resonance commonly used for nuclear resonances. So, and especially in this case, we'll compare electron paramagnetic resonance imaging with nuclear magnetic imaging MRI. What you can see in this comparison is that the frequencies of MRI and EPRI are actually very close. And I will be talking a little bit about that. While MRI, of course, can be acquired at slightly lower frequencies, while EPRI is struggling to get as high as possible, but still within the range of MRI frequencies. While the frequencies are the same, magnetic fields we are using are quite different because of the difference of magnetic moments of the electron. And another experimental trouble what we have is related to relaxation rates. While the proton MRI, protons relaxing very slow, typically in the range of seconds, the EPRI spin probes are relaxing about a million times faster. Another big difference between MRI and EPRI is, of course, the object of observation. And in MRI, we typically look at protons and they are present in samples in high concentration because most of us is water. However, in terms of EPRI, there are no probes endogenous to the samples. Whatever paramagnetic species we have are typically very low concentration and they have very high relaxation rates, so they cannot be observed directly. So what we do for our measurements, we introducing exogenous probes such as nitroxides or trityls, but the concentration of those about 100,000 times less than concentration of the protons. And another interesting aspect is the duration of the experiments or the lifetime of these probes in biological samples is typically defined by minutes to hours, while protons, of course, are stable. So how we approach the instrumental design for EPR when we are focused on animals and biological materials. So major criteria are the following. First of all, we need to have reasonably open system because we want to observe the samples or animals inside the system. We need to have open resonators. We cannot shield them or enclose them because, again, we would like to be able to monitor the samples. We need access to for a variety of gas exchange systems and a variety of other probes. Of course, we cannot do acquisition at helium temperature like many EPI experiments are performed. We have to work at physiologic temperatures. This means at about 37 Celsius. We, of course, need to have access for animal support, breathing support, monitoring systems. And finally, the duration of the experiments, it has to be restricted by the physiologic animal durations. So we cannot image for multiple hours. The choice of frequency. So why this range of frequency and why we're choosing those? Of course, from basic physics, you know that the EPR signal will be increasing with frequency due to the Faraday law and then, of course, the distribution, Boltzmann distribution creating bigger polarization for the higher frequencies of EPR. But unfortunately, with the increase of the frequency, the second effect kicks in, and this is the absorption. Sorry. So the water causes absorption of RF energy, and this effect dramatically increases with frequency as well. So at some point, the no RF can be penetrating inside the sample. And for each size of the sample, we are set to particular range of frequencies. And one can argue that we can select an optimum frequency, which is associated with each object size. So this slide presents just very few of the instruments, but those are very popular frequencies, so to say. So the low end is frequencies of about 250 megahertz. Those instruments are compatible plus minus with any object size. You can potentially use these instruments for human imaging. And as an example, I show a couple of instruments in the University of Chicago. One of them is actually compatible with patients, with humans. So the upper side of the range, I present here the Bruker instrument, which is approximately, I think, 1.2 gigahertz. So these are very high frequency instruments, but they have their own restrictions of the sample size. So for our typical studies, now we are choosing instruments which are in the middle of this range, and about 700 megahertz. Okay, so let's start and look at different parts of the instrumentation separately. So let's start with the magnet. The permanent magnet or constant magnetic field are creating constant magnetic field. And there are two major approaches for construction of these magnets. One is an electric magnet, while another is a permanent magnet. Both of these approaches have their pluses and minuses, and which are summarized in this slide. So as you can see, one of the major problems of the electric magnets is heat, because heat dissipation. And this, of course, is increasing with the increasing of the field. And that's why for intermediate frequency range of 700 megahertz and higher, most designs involve the permanent magnets, which have, of course, their own drawbacks. Another part of the instrumentation, which is important, is a resonator. So as I already mentioned, resonator should be reasonably open so we can insert animals inside. And you can see that one of the design proposed earlier by, I think early 60s, by Jim Hyde is still working well in this setup. And this is a loop gap resonator. So most of our machines use this type of resonance. The major technology used in our lab for imaging is pulse EPR. The reason for that is, as I will be showing later, pulse EPR has a variety of methodologies, and these methodologies allows very precise determination of oxygen. And that's why this technology currently is the leading technology comparing to continuous wave EPR. So how does it work? So what you see on the left side is the same energy level diagram. And what you can see that, of course, the EPR line is not concentrated at one position of magnetic field, it's distributed. And if you want to get information about this line, there are two major approaches. You can change magnetic field and then monitor the intensity, and that's way number one. But what we can do in the pulse acquisition methodology, we can create a pulse which has a broad excitation bandwidth and excite the whole line completely. And then this will give rise to signal, for example, free induction decay, as you see on the right side of the slide. And the Fourier transformation of the slide gives exactly the EPR lines, line shape. So this methodology allows to obtain exactly the same information, but you can get the whole information in just one shot, and that's rising, and that creates great possibility for pulse EPR acquisition. Now from the instrumentation, I move to the spin probes. Of course, no EPR imaging will be possible without the use of spin probes. These spin probes gives EPR signal, and as I will show later, this EPR signal can be, or relaxation, for example, of this spin probe can be related to oxygen concentration in samples. Here you can see four types of spin probes. Of course, there are many more, but those four are used in imaging, very commonly used in imaging. So the first one is a nitroxide radicals. Second one is a triethyl radicals, which have a more complex shape, but as I will show later, they are much more suitable for oximetry. And two other examples are a particulate, so insoluble spin probes, which are presented by lithium phthalocyanine and its derivative. And for example, and type four is a triethyl encapsulated in some media. For example, it can be encapsulated in nanotubes as was shown by us. So major difference in application of these probes is depending on the object of study. So if you want to look at, let's say, animal, and you don't have the target of imaging is not specified initially, it's much better to inject the animal with the soluble probe, which will distribute all over the sample, and then obtain images at any part of the animal of your choice. So the use of particulate probes is a little bit different. In this case, you have to embed these probes prior to the experiment. But the advantage is that being embedded once, it will stay in that part and report oxygen continuously. So giving rise to successful longitudinal measurements. For oxygen imaging, we are mostly using currently triethyl spin probes. So how do we measure oxygen? Oxygen is a very strongly magnetic molecule. So it has a 2 ampere electron. And because of that, it's exhibit a very, very fast relaxation. So at room temperature, it's on the picosecond order. And if it would be nice to observe it in EPR, but with this type of relaxation, it's absolutely impossible at room temperature. However, so what will happen if we have oxygen in the same media as a paramagnetic molecule of our choice, then in this case, water-soluble molecule, then oxygen will be colliding with the probe molecule and giving rise to the effect called Heisenberg exchange when the electrons of the oxygen and spin probe for a short duration of the collision will fill the environment of each other, which will result in relaxing of the spin probe signal. And it's from that it's clear that more oxygen you see you have, the more frequency of collision, and the relaxation rate is obviously modified by the concentration of oxygen. And indeed, if you will make a measurement, for example, for the trital, you can see that there is a perfect linear dependence between the relaxation rate and oxygen concentration. Here, I want you to point you that both phase relaxation are true and spin lattice relaxation are one, are affected in a very similar way. So, and here as well, I would like to summarize the reasons why we would like to use trital for oxygen images. The one and the most important advantage of the tritals, because it's a rapidly tumbling molecule, it's averaging all interactions within the molecule. And what we see is a very narrow line, which allows us to produce high images with the high resolution. Trials have relatively slow relaxation for EPR standard. It's an extremely slow relaxation, which allows us to use pulse EPR. And finally, trials are very non-toxic and they exhibit relatively slow clearance from animals, which allow to inject trital and get very high quality oxygen. From the spin probes, now I will move into technology of EPR oxygen images. Interestingly enough, the technology associated on which based EPR oxygen imaging is very, very close to the technology which was demonstrated is very suitable for MRI. So the original paper in which Paul Waterberg demonstrated magnetic resonance imaging, in fact, demonstrated the way in which we imaging samples right now. So let's look at this picture from the Nature publication and see how we will construct the image using EPR. So if we will put object injected with spin probes and we will observe a spectrum of EPR at no gradient of magnetic field, at constant magnetic field, we will see just one line. However, if we have a spatial distribution of spin probe, in this case, two vertical tubes, and I will be showing only the planar imaging in the plane. So what we will have, it will be dependent on magnetic field gradient. Magnetic field gradient modifies the magnetic field as a function of spatial position. And in this case, linearly, that's, so if the direction of the gradient is so that the object one exhibit magnetic field smaller and object two magnetic field higher, what we will see, our line will split in two, giving rise to the two different lines like that. So if we'll change my orientation of the gradient in the plane, and now both of the lines again have magnetic resonance at the same position. So we again see the one line. And if we will orient magnetic field in arbitrary position, so we'll see something in between of one and two lines. What's really interesting is that these spectras can be related back to the original image through the inverse Radon transformation. It's a very well-known transformation. And what's interesting, this transformation is analytical. And it's proven that having infinite amount of projections, you can perfectly reconstruct the original image. And I have to mention that the spectras, what we observe, it's in terms of image, they call projections. So this is the one way of looking on the image formation. It's so-called space domain reconstruction. However, another way of reconstruction of image formation can be presented if we will move into K-space. So K-space is a space, Fourier transformed space from the original image. So as you can see, you can have an image and then Fourier transform it and this collection of pixels will be the Fourier image of the original image. What's the advantage of this approach of a representation? It's let us to map the signal which we acquire in the pulse EPR to the k-space, and we know that we can obtain original image just by Fourier transformation of this k-space. So let's see how this mapping occur. So what you see in the middle is the electron spin echo two pulse sequence, which contains of two RF pulses. And these two pulses giving a rise to a signal, to the echo signal. And if you will look at the slope of the echo outline in red and look at the K space on the right, you will see that this trace starting from the tip of the echo, which will be at the origin of the coordinates, and with time duration, the K space will be traced from the origin to the outside. So basically one spin echo allows to acquire a line, or how they call it, spike in image processing. So it's clear that if you will rotate the gradient, the angle of this line towards the coordinates will change, and we can cover the all K space. So if all K space will be covered, we are basically ready for the image reconstruction. So this is the way how we obtaining electron spin echo images. And one of the major advantage of this way is this acquisition is fast, because at one experiment, at one shot of the echo, we obtain multiple K space points. Another advantage of this method is that it can be combined with many different pulse sequences. So if you want to determine different aspects of the EPR signal, we can achieve that. However, this method is coupled to some negative effects. And one of these effects is a relaxation will be affecting the signal, because while we tracing the K space along the shape of the echo, it's also the relaxation goes along. And what this means that maximum of the signal we observe at origin of coordinate, but the higher K space points we measure, they will be attenuated by the relaxation. And higher K space point associated with the resolution of the image. And this means that we have to acquire enough K space point within the relaxation time of the spin probe. The second effect is because we are sampling the K space not uniformly, we will have to use some kind of transformation to be able to Fourier transform the final set, either by interpolation or by prediction of the spin points of the K space points. And this gives rise to the imaging artifact. The way to circumvent this is called single point EPR imaging. This technology allows to acquire each K space point at a time. It could be arbitrary K space point. So naturally this way of acquisition is, in terms of image quality, is more superior, because now we're getting no artifacts, we're getting no attenuation of high K points, so we get perfect image representation. But the drawback and the price for that method is, of course, that you can take only one point at a time in the K space, which reduces the speed of acquisition. However, in our research, we are trying to use both of these methods, because it's clear that this second method has better image quality. So how we form the images of oxygen? So what I just described form as a spatial image. The method is the following. So we couple the acquisition using electron spin echo, for example, with pulse sequences which can measure relaxation. In this case, what I'm showing is inversion recovery T1 imaging. So in front of the spin echo acquisition sequence, we are putting inversion pulse, which flips the magnetization. And then by moving the acquisition, the detection sequence further and further, we are observing the relaxing of the magnetization towards its initial state with the rate of a spin lattice relaxation. And if we accumulate certain amount of these images, like three, for example, shown in this picture, and feed each voxels of these images to the exponential recovery, we will get the relaxation time. And then knowing the calibration coefficients, this relaxation will be converted into oxygen, as shown on the picture on the right. Of course, what I'm showing is impossible without heavy mathematics and software for data acquisition and data processing. So instrumentation in our lab is running on acquisition side, the Specman 4 API. This is the commercial software, which can acquire data on API spectrometers. And for image processing, we're using the what we call API imaging toolbox. It's actually freely available, can be downloaded from our website. So contact me if you're interested in this software. So now I will tell just one slide explaining why we prefer to use spin lattice relaxation to phase relaxation. Because these two methods have both relaxations have very similar dependence on oxygen, as you can see in the left upper slide. However, what was found, this spin lattice relaxation has much, much smaller dependence on the concentration, as you can see in the left bottom picture. And what that results with, because when you're injecting, for example, the animal, you don't know what's exact concentration of spin probe will be at any particular position. And for that, so this concentration will have some effect on the relaxation times. And what you can see on the right side, if you will take an animal and start increasing concentration in the animal by just changing rate of the injection, what you can see with the increase of concentration, the relaxation, the spin lattice relaxation stays almost constant, while the phase relaxation is increasing. And that's why we prefer to run spin lattice relaxation imaging as the most close approximation of the absolute oxygen imaging. In summary, EPR in vivo imaging is a very interesting modality which can image oxygen with very high oxygen resolution. It gives spatial resolution of millimeter and slightly better than millimeter. We can get these images for objects like mice within 5 to 10 minutes. And on the right, you can see how EPR allows you to resolve the concentration of oxygen in a tumor of a mouse subjected to the oscillating a breathing atmosphere. So it goes from 21% oxygen to 95% oxygen. And what you can see, and that's what was experimentally proven, that oxygen in the muscle of the animal is changing dramatically during these oscillations, but in tumor it stays the same, and that's the experimental proof. And of course, it's now I have to present the instrument which we designed at O2M, and here it is. This is Jiva 25. It's a 720 megahertz EPR oxygen imager based on the pulse acquisition. So it's reasonably small. It can be maintained, located in any lab. And as you can see, it's only 120 centimeter in height. Its magnet is prominent, and the gradient system is located on the top of this machine. It has a vertical and a horizontal access, so you can do both animals and in vitro samples, which are typically liquid, so you prefer to insert them vertically. So all this machine, what you see is a complete instrument. So you don't need a separate console or computer. It's has a number of accessories which are still in the development, but some of them are already used. And all these accessories allows to image animals and inanimate samples. And this machine is controlled by Jiva 25 software called OxyView. And this software allows to use this machine for people with not very big knowledge of EPR. So you can focus on what you're imaging and not on the aspects of the imaging per se. And you can see the screenshot, and the software has a lot of automated routines, which allows imaging, makes imaging process simple. So from this, I will just quickly mention a couple of the applications. Hal already was talking that one of the biggest application for EPR oximetry is currently, it's a cancer studies. And this application, what I'm bringing your attention to, it's oxygen-guided radiation therapy. And of course, it will be presented in much more details in the next lecture of the series by Howard Halpern from the University of Chicago. And I will just give you some gist of how it works. So what you see here is the MRI image, and the brighter area outlined is the tumor. And of course, the current therapies, they deliver homogeneous dose of radiation to the tumor because there is no way to figure out how resistant tumor tissues are to radiation. And we know that hypoxic areas in tumors are about 3 times more resistant to radiation than areas with normal oxygenation. But without oxygen image, it's impossible to determine. And that's why, to be sure, you have to blast with radiation the whole tumor. And that will affect not only tumor, because as you know, radiation is traveling along the, it will propagate the whole sample. So we will create significant doses in areas bordering the tumor and potentially can damage some critical organs. So, however, if you have EPR oxygen image or oxygen image, then if you overlap the image, now you have the information which areas are homogeneous, which areas have low oxygen and which areas have high oxygen. And then instead of delivering homogeneous dose of radiation, you will deliver, for example, two-dose scheme when periphery of the tumor, which seems highly oxygenated, will get low dose, but the hypoxic core of the tumor will get a high dose. And as we were showing in our studies, this method indeed allows with the use of with this scheme to reduce dramatically the dose delivered to the animals. And these two plots are showing the difference between survival of the cohort of animals which have hypoxia boost, which is the scheme I presented, and hypoxia avoidance boost, which delivers very similar radiation dose, but in a scheme which is different from what I'm showing. So you see the same radiation dose can have a dramatically different effect. And potentially with the development of this scheme, we hope to reduce the radiation dose delivered to patient, improving quality of their lives post radiation treatment. Another example what I chose is biomaterials. And just to illustrate what you can see in biomaterials, I'm showing in this slide two very simple examples. You have in these examples a vial full of water, and okay, there is a trital in the water, and we are looking at oxygenation of the trital. And what we do, we bubble through this water a gas which is going from air to nitrogen. And of course, what you expect that with the time the water getting oxygenated or deoxygenated, and we are observing the oscillations of oxygenation in the sample. So if we're putting the straw to the bottom, the whole area, volume of water will be bubbled, of course, and this allows to equilibrate oxygen quite rapidly in the sample. In this case, you can see that a quarter of an hour is sufficient to fully oxygenate and deoxygenate the sample. While if you pull straw just to the surface, you're still bubbling the water, but only on the surface, you see that the oxygenation time is changing to multiple hours. And of course, if you're dealing with the real biomaterials, you typically have cells and you have a frame, a structure, which holds the cells. And if you want the cells to survive, you would like to have a high oxygenation, but oxygen can be delivered only to the surface of the samples. So this method, what we're demonstrating here, allows you to choose the materials, the media, the concentration of cells to achieve the success of this bio samples. And another example I just took from Ignayani, it's showing identical biomaterial. It's basically a fresh gelatin. However, what's the different in this study is that one study is performed on the fresh gelatin, another one over gelatin which is stay overnight. And you can see what will happen if you will start on the deoxygenated sample and you start to expose it to oxygen atmosphere. In the fresh sample, in 13 hours, you get oxygen penetrating to every point of the sample. While if you leave the gelatin overnight, you can see that this process of oxygenating the sample goes much, much slower. So if you imagine the effect this technology can have the impact on the whole field of bioengineering, when you can actually see the oxygenation of sample and seeing that means you can choose, you can optimize your methodology for bringing the samples, for developing the samples, to selecting the cells concentration, etc. With that slide, I am finishing my presentation. I would like to thank all collaborators and partners to contribute to this talk and contribute to the field of oximetry and EPR oximetry. And I have to acknowledge the funding agency which is supporting this work. Thank you.
Thank you, Boris. I think we are ready for question and answer. Please write your questions in chat box or speak up here. Forum is open for everyone to contribute, suggest, comment, or ask question to speaker. You may need to unmute yourself. So Boris, you talk about the trital and a little bit of other probes. Maybe you can elaborate more on that, different probes and how they can be useful in different situations.
Okay, so let me move back to the probes. Okay, so as I already mentioned, the two major classes of spin probes used as soluble and non-soluble or particulate probes. And they have their own different ways, different application strategies. And the soluble probes, of course, are very convenient in case if you cannot in advance determine which part of object you would like to image. So in case, for example, of animals, I mean, the tumor, let's say, grows whenever it grows, and you want to determine oxygenation of the tumor, you inject systemically these probes into animals, and this light up the whole animal. So you, after you inject it systemically, you can observe most of the parts of anatomy of animal. For example, I mean, trital can highlight most of part of animals beside the brain because it cannot penetrate the blood-brain barrier. So if you, however, the disadvantage of these probes is that they come into animal and then they getting, they slowly getting out of the animal system. So, and you lose the signal. So if you want to do consequent longitudinal measurements, you have to do continuous injection or inject whenever you want to monitor. This problem can be alleviated by the insoluble spin probes. So those you can either inject into the place of interest or implant in some way, and they stay essentially forever. So now you can see the signal from these probes over the whole longitudinal study. But of course, if you want to see oxygenation next to this point, you can't because there are no probes there. So that's the difference.
Hi, Boris. It's Michał here from Krakow. It's nice to see you and thank you for a great presentation. I would like to ask you about one thing. Like, you talk about single point imaging and you show that it is suitable for pulse imaging, but there is a few papers that single point imaging is also made by continuous wave EPR. And you can get the information about the T2 star, which means indirectly by the oxygen. But in your opinion, the CW, SPI, and pulse SPI, is it equivalent or there is a huge, some difference between information you obtain?
Thank you, Michal. It's an interesting question, actually. In general, I mean, I don't, I never use SPI in a CW way. I saw a number of papers showing that this is advantages. I would say, from general, my understanding is because CW is, because SPI has no damage from, relaxation doesn't damage SPI acquisition. So of course, this method is very beneficial for whatever technology you will couple it with. But how, in terms of signal to noise, it's compared between CW SPI and pulse SPI, it's hard for me to say.
Okay. Thank you, Boris.
Do we have any other question from audience?
I probably can add one thing that the SPI, especially modern modifications of SPI from the recent publications from the NCI group of Murali Krishna, they managed to move from T2 star to acquisition of T1. And as I showed in this presentation, spin lattice relaxation is much closer related to oxygen. So here I would say pulse SPI might have some advantage over CW.
Thank you.
Hi, Boris, I have a question.
Hello. Yes. Hello, please ask a question.
Yeah, hello. My name is Mikołaj. I am from Poznań. I have a question about the last experiment you show us about with the gelatin. Could you tell me something more about the experiment, how you prepare this gelatin?
Okay. In fact, I think this question probably is better answered by Mrignani because that's her slide. So I will put the slide and maybe Mrignani can comment on that.
I think the gelatin was prepared usually by probably boiling the gelatin in water. The only difference was the fresh gelatin. We made the gelatin and measurements started right away after 1 hour. So the sample was deoxygenated and then we observed then after deoxygenation, we circulated 5% oxygen on top of the sample. And the other gelatin overnight, it's here after making gelatin, the tube was put it in a fridge for overnight and the measurement started in the morning. So this is 1% gelatin, so it's not actually gel in a sense, it's pretty viscous liquid. But you can see the difference in oxygenation. Even though we are circulating the gas, 5% gas mixture on top of the sample, the fresh gelatin quickly kind of starts getting oxygenated. And this is 30 minute, 1 hour. I don't have more slide, I should have, but within 2 hours, most of the sample is oxygenated, but in overnight gelatin, it takes much longer. And even after 16 hour, you can see that bottom part is still has a 20 tor, where top part is 40 tor. 40 tor is 5% oxygen.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, there is a question coming. It would be interesting to see your 3D maps and dissolved oxygen optical sensor data side by side for 3D tissue culture experiments. I mean, I agree, and I think some data will be shown in the following lectures, especially concerning biomaterials.
We do have some data side by side with oxylite sensor, and we realized that our technology is much more standard. Their sensors are not calibrated for various biomaterials as well as high oxygen. So I'll show those data in my presentation sometime. Thank you, Greta, for your question.
So I have one more question about the 3D imaging. What is the minimum time to get a 3D image? The minimum time?
The minimum time is plus minus determined by the agility of gradients of our current system can do about 40 seconds. Okay, but it can be accelerated more, but of course you get penalty in terms of signal to noise of the images. However, again, we kind of advanced methods of filtration of the images probably can bring your resolution to this level. Also, it was demonstrated by us that you can change image acquisition strategies, and instead of collecting consequently the images, you can change the projection acquisition in a way that you can group some groups of projection and from a single image produce multiple images with better time resolution. So I would assume that we can do better than half minute, probably towards 10, 15 seconds, this order.
And this 10 seconds will be only 3D, so spin probe distribution in the sample, or it will be temporal resolution and spatial resolution at the same time?
I was talking about 4D. 3D probably can be faster because current technology of 4D includes 10 images and feeding this to the recovery. So probably divided by 10 is about the estimation. So So 3D images, I probably I would assume with certain modification of technique can be reached in seconds maybe, while 4D oxygen images can be on the order of 10, 15 seconds.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
And I have a, one more question about the resonator in your equipment. Could you tell me something more about the resonator, about the quality factor, and what is the minimum spin concentration you can achieve the proper signal from it?
Yes, that's a great question. So the resonators what we are using is are the loop gap resonators. So the for small objects, it's typically two loops, I mean, one loop, two gap resonators. The concentration of spin probes, according to our calibration, is on the order of 250 to 300 micromolar in the animals, which allows us to get reasonable quality images. So it's, of course, at lower, lower oxygen, at high oxygen side, you probably need higher concentrations of spin probe. I guess, did I miss some part of your question? Can you remind me?
No, no, thank you.
Oh, thanks. We have developed for low frequency the Alderman Grant resonators, which were giving higher SNR data, but they're a little bit complex to build. So and it's involves basically quality control. It's hard to build resonator with the same specifications again and again, while the loop gap resonators production technology is very straightforward and it's rather simple. So that's why we are using them. So we offer, I mean, as an O2M, we offer resonators from about 10 millimeters in diameter to about 40 millimeters, I think 1.5 inch in diameters. So that's our sizes. And I think above this size, we probably will have to switch to the loop gap, sorry, to the surface loop resonators, because the power requirements will be too high to excite the whole volume.
I just wanted to add that both resonator, we have vertical axis as well as horizontal axis, because some samples require vertical sample orientation, especially biomaterial samples.
Yeah, so the GIVA25 machine has two types of resonators which are interchangeable, and access is available both from top and from the side.
If there are no more questions, I would like to thank all of you for joining us today. And I hope you will join us again on December 7th when Howard will be talking about oxygen-guided radiation therapy. And on January 15th, when Greg will be talking about the radiation biology experiment. And thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining our inauguration webinar. And have a great week, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for a great talk.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.